counter insurgency operation in Lower Assam. And I see many names that are familiar. Many, of course, may not know me, but I can even see General Naidu, for the former vice chief, on the list here. And you know, then it puts pressure after these two erudite presentations on perhaps the only non-military fellow sitting here and trying to talk about military issues or the comprehensive national power. But nevertheless, I'll try my best to analyze or at least look ahead to the best of my ability, the way I see it and the way it must pan out. But before we get into what is India's likely roadmap for enhancing capability and taking on the challenges, I think we also need to do a quick scan of the geopolitics or the churn in geopolitics that is happening currently. Indo-Pacific, of course, is the current flavor of the season. The Quad is gaining in traction, at least from the main driver of Quad, that is the United States, and of course, Australia and then Japan. I'm not so sure if India is very fully invested in Quad for various reasons. India might want the Quad to be effective in, say, supply chain management or supply chain shifting from China to the other countries for vaccines, for climate change. But militarily, I think India is being very pragmatic about the utility of Quad, because ultimately it is only India which has a disputed land border with China and will have to deal with China on its own steam and bilaterally. So I think India is going rather slow, despite a lot of pushing and prodding by the United States to join the corner, as it were, in the boxing ring against China, which I think is a pragmatic step. And we must fight our own battles. We'll have to fight our own battles, because all of you defense, former defense veterans or defense veterans now and former defense officials would agree that none of these countries, Australia, Japan or United States, is going to come to our military aid if the balloon goes up against China again in the near future. So therefore, when we plan for any eventuality and we plan for any likely scenario, I think India needs to factor in, and India is factoring in, these aspects of geopolitics. India also has to look at our near neighborhood or the subcontinent and see what it can do better. If you look at our neighbors, I don't think we've been able to completely keep them on our side for various reasons. China has deeper pockets, so they sort of buy them over in many cases. India's own response or own approach to the neighborhood has been rather erratic. We overpromise and underdeliver in many cases, and therefore the neighbors always play the old game of playing against playing China against India or India against China, and always getting the best out of both in those terms. But India will have to up its game in the neighborhood if it has to keep the neighborhood peaceful. If it needs to take on China in a comprehensive and an effective manner. So what was India's response in 2020 and 2021? I think it's been spoken enough by the people who know it, who have personally handled all the plans and the kind of responses. General Rakesh Sharma, in fact, was leading the Corps, the Fire and Fury Corps, when the previous Depsang incident happened in 2013. So nobody knows that better than him. But the situation has changed. While the Chinese tried to militarily coerce India, India's response after the initial hesitation and surprise and being caught by surprise, I think was superb. What the Chinese have done in trying to coerce India militarily, I don't think they had any plans to go in for or initiate a wider conflict. You can correct me if I'm wrong, because the numbers that they brought in were not enough to earn any decisive victory in the battlefield. It was merely a kind of pressure tactics, and I think India responded well by mirroring the deployment. But what the Chinese have done by doing this tactical mistake that they have lost India strategically. India therefore not only militarily responded to the Chinese action, but also took actions in other fields like banning the apps, keeping Huawei out of the 5G auctions, also looking at investments coming from China much more closely and under very intense scrutiny, putting them under intense scrutiny. All that happened. But militarily, I think General Sharma spoke about it, and I think the current Northern Army commander also mentioned to me in the interview we did in the immediate aftermath of the disengagement in Pangang So and Kailash Range, that 2010 when I visited him, he was the brigade commander in Tangse. There used to be two battalions on the ground looking after the entire eastern Ladakh frontier. India was anyway planning the reorientation towards the northern frontier. The plans were already in place and it was gradually progressing well. But by doing what the Chinese did last year, I think they hastened India's building of the infrastructure and rejigging the deployment in Ladakh and eastern Ladakh and all along the northern frontier, which I think would have happened in any way adequately or in adequate numbers by 2025. But the Chinese have telescoped it, forced us to telescope that deployment and that improvement of infrastructure in by 4 years or so. So India has done well in doing what it has done there. And as we speak, I think yesterday's 12th round of core commanders talks would also lead to further disengagements at a couple of places. But India will have to do a little more than what it has done in terms of infrastructure, in terms of deployment and improving its planning for taking on the Chinese, any Chinese adventure, misadventure, whatever you want to call it. While defensively, I think all of you will agree that it's 2020 or 2021 is no longer 1962. We have demonstrated that enough. Even in 67 and then later in 86, 87 in Sundaramchu, and of course in Ladakh now in 2021. As far as defenses are concerned, or the defensive posture is concerned, I don't think the Chinese are going to have, or I forgot even Doklam, where we showed a proactive approach towards blocking the Chinese from doing what they were trying to do at the Tri-Junction. Now, I think the defenses are strong, but India needs to develop offensive capability too, which will have to be a very deliberate action, very well planned, tri-services, if not two services in the Indian Air Force and the Indian Army must do this. And those solutions will have to be also technology oriented. I mean, India will have to, General Rakesh Sharma spoke about the Chinese way of fighting, or what they want to fight, what is their strength, non-contact, non-kinetic warfare that they want to indulge in. We are certainly lacking there, and I think that should be our intense focus, and not acquiring or putting boots on the ground, because the Chinese are not going to take on the Indians in that respect, at least in that inhospitable terrain of Aksai Chin or across the Himalayas. So what India needs and what India needs to do militarily first, and then I'll speak about the other two or three aspects. One is, of course, to look at modern technology and technology-based solutions. So ISR needs to be drastically improved. It needs to be three-tiered. You need a strategic ISR first to be able to determine the movement of forces from Tibet or Xinjiang to Aksai Chin, for instance, or to near our McMahon line in Arunachal Pradesh, or in the IB around Sikkim. We need three-tier ISR. So first strategic ISR, then also locally, tactically, all our forces and formations need to be aware of what the Chinese are up to in their own area of operations when they are deployed there. And it's just not the army troops on the ground, but also the Air Force must be able to contribute and also alert the army troops. The exchange of information between India Army and the Indian Air Force needs to improve there. I think the drones and anti-drones, or what they call UAS and anti-UAS systems, which I'm sure were being part of the armory of both Indian Army and the Indian Air Force, needs to get larger numbers. We need to focus on more training of our personnel in getting those both tactical and strategic ISR from with the help of the drones and the we must have anti-drone systems to defend ourselves, because the Chinese are going to indulge in long range vectors. They're going to do standoff weapons, and also they're capable of paralyzing our cyber infrastructure or communications network. So India has to be well prepared to take on that. Now that's the kind of defensive posture again I'm talking about. As far as offensive capabilities are concerned, India again needs to invest in long range missiles. It needs to invest in the Air Force, having more capability to price open the S-400 defenses that the Chinese are reported to have put up in Tibet and also along the Indian border. So who will bring that? That ability will come from perhaps partly from Rafale, but maybe in the future India must look at F-35 to be acquired from the Americans, who are at one point were willing to sell F-35s at $95 million a piece, the bare-bone aircraft. India must look at that option, maybe strategically, and get that number from the US if it wants India to be in the quad corner as a willing partner. Maybe that can be one way of getting that. The political and national will has been demonstrated adequately in the past 3-4 instances, but by just demonstrating that will, it will not deter the Chinese. It will have to be some kind of a punitive or a quid pro quo action that will have to be put in place immediately if there is a kind of indication that the Chinese are up to some mischief. I think there is no point of having such large armed forces or capable armed forces if they're not able to translate the national will or the political will into some kind of a punitive action against either Pakistan or China, which brings me to the threat that we face on so-called two fronts. But I think if we can tackle China, then it's easy to then deal with Pakistan, because in my view, Pakistan is a subset of the main Chinese challenge. I think India should keep changing, change its approach towards how to deal with these two countries. If you deal with China firmly, if you deal with China on an equal footing, I think the Pakistanis will also get the message. I think that should be the approach as far as I'm concerned. I may be wrong again there, but that is where it is coming. Coming to use of comprehensive national power, India needs to build not just military power, but also economic power. I think that is where the stark difference between China and India is showing up, that we are in a bad shape economically. And unless we pull up our boots, pull up our socks and get the economy going, where we create wealth, where we create deep pockets, we will not be able to take on the Chinese confidently. We are capable of, as I said, defending our borders and our territorial integrity. But if we need to deter the Chinese, nothing deters the Chinese more than strength, both military, I would think, and economic. And to do that, India needs to change some of its policies, maybe even rethink of joining RCEP going forward, maybe in a couple of years' time, because that's a major trading bloc. India needs to do a lot of FTAs, free trading agreements with countries in South Asia and Southeast Asia. Also, create alliances or bilateral alliances with like-minded countries. Don't be shy of giving Vietnam at least the Akash missiles, if not the BrahMos. We keep talking about it for a long time. Philippines has been asking for it for a long time, because India alone, as the Americans have realized, India alone cannot deter the Chinese juggernaut, or at least stop it. So India, while guarding its own borders, while always being on guard, on the borders and all the Chinese mischief that the Chinese do against India, it also needs to create these small alliances, bilateral, minilateral, multilateral alliances with countries like Philippines, Vietnam, Indonesia, And also look at giving Mongolia some kind of a help, because nothing riles the Chinese more than the small pinpricks that one can actually give them. As you've seen what's happening in the Olympics, one small anthem being played, or Taiwanese being called the Chinese Taipei, or Taiwan, I mean, called by the name Taiwan, riles the Chinese. I have said this before, the Chinese, we also need to play the game of information warfare with the Chinese far better than we have been doing. Info ops, the defenses, as well as offensive capability in cyber and space needs to be really upgraded, because the Chinese are not going to come and fight the battle on the ground, or face to face, what India thinks it will. It is not going to happen. Also, I think this needs to be more dialogue between the political executive and the military leadership. There needs to be more jointness. We are going through the throes of the debate that we are seeing right now, which is a perpetual debate. I think at some point the political dispensation will just force it down the throat of the three services, and they'll have to accept it if they don't get their act together quickly. Because it took nearly 20 years to get the CDS in place, but now there is impatience in the political establishment. If the proposed jointness, integration, and enhancing of combat capability does not happen on its own by the three services, I think there is a clear-cut warning or clear-cut writing on the wall about this. The three services need to get their act together and not think in terms of silos. They need to do joint planning, they need to do more joint training, and evolve a joint doctrine, I think, which is more effective and which is looking at the practical aspects of war fighting. In fact, General Sharma referred to the Prime Minister's speeches. I always refer to his 2015 address to the Combined Commanders Conference on board INS Vikramaditya. If you read that abridged edition of his speech, I think it clearly lays down what is in the mind of the leadership, the national leadership, as far as armed forces are concerned. I'm not sure if the military leadership has fully comprehended the plans that are there, or the plans that are there in the minds of the political leadership. And therefore, I think they need to revisit, they need to absorb what the Prime Minister has said a number of times, even at Kevadia earlier this year. I think there were several aspects that the Prime Minister pointed out, and the armed forces need to get their act together there. I think one or two final points I want to make. We need to be very clear about who is our main and the primary and the secondary objective. While I think Air Marshal Chopra said, we, or General Rakesh Sharma himself said, we shouldn't be preparing for two-front war, but we should be preparing to avoid a two-front war or two-and-a-half-front war, which is right. But as I keep repeating, and I'm repeating again myself here, that if we can tackle China, I think the Pakistani problem can also be tackled simultaneously, or in the wake of the tackling of the Chinese challenge. We need more Mandarin speakers. We need more people to understand China, not just militarily, but also socially and politically. Very few people in India have the ability to either read, write, or speak Mandarin, or even get into the minds of the Chinese. Since we don't know our enemy enough, it's not going to be easy to subdue the enemy. If you have to really go by what Sun Tzu said, or what Chanakya has said at various places, unless you know the enemy, you will not be able to create policies and doctrines and tactics or strategies to deal with the enemy. So to know that enemy, I think we need more than maybe 1 lakh Mandarin speakers, young scholars who are schooled in not just speaking, but also interpreting various documents that the Chinese put out after huge deliberation. I think we need to create that ecosystem, more think tanks, more serious study, not cut and paste jobs. Not copying and pasting from the American or the European thoughts, but our own thoughts. I think we need that. And information warfare. We need to be more proactive in terms of media interaction, in terms of proactive deception and misinformation to be directed at the Chinese. We need to have our own voice on the international stage in terms of what, say, the Xinhua has or the CGTN has. I'm not sure how many of you are aware that there are 2,000 Chinese bureaus and more than about 1.5 lakh Chinese journalists working across the globe. They don't only be journalists, they are also open source intelligence collection agents who give you information about every open society. Finally, just one final thought, that remember, this is a fight between two different systems. The Chinese are autocratic as they get, as autocratic and as opaque as they get. We are as democratic, chaotic, and as open as they get. And therefore, the fight will be very different because their approach is different, our approach is different. And if we have to really understand how the Chinese function, we need to get into their minds, into their planning, their perspective, and create an alliance, as I said, or alliances, number of alliances across the globe. But ultimately, last line I want to say, ultimately we have to be on our own. We will be on our own to take on the Chinese. There is enough being done. There's a lot being done, but I think even that is not enough. We need to do much more comprehensively, not just in terms of military capability, but all other capabilities. I'll stop here and thank you again for this opportunity. And thank you for such an august audience that I got an opportunity to interact with. Thank you, Brigadier Sinha, and.